Welcome back to the Modern Old School Training Podcast. I'm Aaron King with Coach Bob King. And today's topic is we're going to touch on some nutrition. Now, neither one of us are nutritionists, but there are a lot of things we can learn as far as a framework. And then we'll have some more scientific folks come on the show and really break down maybe macronutrients and things like that. But nutrition is such a big deal. And I dealt with this a lot when I was crashing a lot after workouts and having a really poor recovery for a while. And I was like, man, maybe my body's just, I'm just done. And then little simple things like just adding raisins and some simple sugars within that first 15 minutes after my workout, kind of the recovery side, getting the simple carbs, things like that, changed everything. So what are some – how do you want to frame this conversation? Where do you want to start?
Well, let's start with what we know to be truth across the board. There are macronutrients, as you just alluded to, we have to have. We have to have protein, a certain amount of fat, and carbohydrates. Your brain essentially runs on sugar in simple terms. Fat is important for cell wall construction and other functions in the body. And, of course, protein, that's what we are. And so the macronutrients are there. There are the micronutrients and so forth that we need, but those vary in ranges, right? You can look at a bottle and say of vitamins or something, and it goes 300 micrograms, 1,000% of daily RDA. Well, okay, let's talk a second. I'm around 215. I may have a friend of mine who's like 130. Do we eat the same? Do we eat as much? Do we have the same requirements from a energy standpoint? Well, depending on size, yes and no. We have a baseline, but then activity levels, metabolic rate, all those things are going to affect how much of what it is I eat. Now, the sticky wicket is research is pouring out daily as we speak on topics that we just are having a hard time keeping up with. Now, let me give you some examples. Glycemic index. Looked into that years and years, decades ago, because that is what glycemic index tells you what you eat and what it does to your blood sugar levels. And so you can go look that up, Google it and so forth, and it'll say, hey, this, you know, white rice glycemic index, watch out. It'll make you crash. Okay, maybe I don't disagree, but maybe I also know that I don't ever just sit down and eat a plate of white rice. It's going to have a protein in it. I do put soy sauce on it with the salt intake and so forth. So I'm not getting the pure glycemic response that the chart says, that this is a such and such a level. So when you look at intake, what does your body do with it and how does it respond?
That's the big thing right there. Now, absolutely, there's more and more tests coming out. I know some startups that are doing some cool tech where you can basically have an app that you send in your blood results, or you send your blood and then they give you the results through your app, tells you what you can eat, what you can't eat based on your DNA. It's so specific to the person. Glycemic index, cereals and protein bars, all those things are ridiculously high in the glycemic index. Yeah. So you think you're eating healthy or you're getting the right types of carbs. So you gotta really pay attention to that stuff. The blood sugar thing. Now, how does that affect, let's talk a little bit about how that might, your energy levels.
Well, there's a couple of things. There's rebound hypoglycemia, which I think you were alluding to, where you have a sugar intake, you exercise, and you have a spike and then a rapid decline. And so you have to know your body's response to it. We have to have a certain amount of sugar or sugar converted into glycogen, the carbohydrates, so the muscle can contract and the brain can function. The body will convert whatever it needs into the glucose it does need, whether it's through using fat or if you're in a starved state, it'll take protein out of your body and break it down to use as energy as well. So it's something we have to understand. We need carbohydrates. The problem is they're so accessible in terrible forms that we get too much of it. Mm-hmm. So if I go back, grab a bag of cookies and go, well, here's my sugar intake. Well, your body is going to get that insulin spike in response and get rid of all that sugar. And now you've got nothing in the bloodstream. So when you start exercising, you crash because, wait, where'd all my sugar go? Yeah. Well, it got, you know, taken away by the insulin.
Well, those processed sugars are the problem.
You know, that's the problem.
The simple sugars that might come from, raisins were my go-to because they're easy. And that was, I liked them. They tasted good, but they're easy to package and keep in my gym bag. So eat some simple like that because bananas are great, but They go bad, and you know, so there's sometimes it's just as simply as it's logistical, but I've noticed lately. So this has been kind of the fad, intermittent fasting.
Yeah,
I've noticed in my training now, you know, I'm 34 years old and I don't take supplements. I eat pretty light, very low calorie. Yeah. So I'll have eggs. I'll have like four eggs, two or an avocado in the morning. And I'll go, I'll have a snack in the middle of the day, maybe some nuts or something around 11-ish. So I'll eat it. I'll eat a late breakfast because I try to get that 12 to 14 hours in the intermittent fasting.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so that egg and avocado will be around 10.
Right.
Snack around, you know, 11, noon, something. So pretty quick turnaround. But then I won't eat a real meal until probably 2 or 3 in the afternoon. And that's salad usually with some chicken or some salmon. But I've noticed that even with a low calorie and not a lot of carbohydrates, I've had a lot of energy, both mentally and physically.
You do feel better. They have, currently, 2019, there's a lot of movement towards intermittent fasting is negotiable. I have done that. We had this going back 20 years ago, and I didn't know what to call it because we called it a reverse fast. And so what that meant was when you finish eating at night, don't eat until you just can't stand not to eat in the next day. And so we just call it a reverse fast because most people think, you know, I go to bed, I wake up, and I just won't eat all day, and that's my fast. Well, I just said do it overnight because you got probably 8 hours, and it's easy. At least it is for me. Now, to your point, if you do have a restricted calorie, there's a very fine line. These are concepts that are being looked at more closely that come out of long done research. And there's a term called calorie restriction as opposed to starving. And so it's just like under eating, under nutrition, not malnutrition or starvation. And so your body will adapt. And we say this all the time. What's the human body made for? Adapting. So it will learn to be more efficient. You'll feel better. I'm always been an advocate of avoiding extremes. So I'm not so much into ketosis. That was a super find for a epilepsy that they carried over into everyday, you know, people. There's the carnivore diet. We're not going to eat anything but meat because that's what I am. I'm beef. Mm-hmm. And then, so we have all these extremes. But the fasting aspect of it has picked up momentum because we overload our systems, and when I say systems, endocrine, digestive, and so forth, even the cardiovascular system, with trying to process and digest a constant eating that Americans especially are good at. So what you want to do is say, you know, how much do I need? Come in under that. But you get the qualities of the macronutrients. You get the glucose you need or the carbohydrates you need. You get the fats you need. For me, just because of my early days of study, I'm a high protein guy. I drink it and eat it as much as I can in my workouts. I'd limit my supplements to kind of the macro kind of things. I'll do some creatine, which is in meat. I'll do protein, which again, that's who we are. So, you know, you just have to be smart about how many calories did I just end up taking? Why am I getting heavier? Well, that tells you your nutrition's gone down the wrong path.
Well, that goes back to just, it depends on who you are. So you say a lot of protein. You know, I found myself to be sluggish if I have certain things. Mm-hmm. So it's very specific to the person. Now, one thing I noticed too, so I have did the blood pressure experiment that we'll have the video coming out here hopefully soon. But I noticed that you have the kind of diminishing returns to a point where if I try to like say I need to get to that 14-hour mark, I want to really stay true to fasting or whatever, mm-hmm. the intermittent fasting. Well, there was times where, say, I have stress at work and I haven't eaten.
Yes.
Then you have that's where I got into the just practical life application where it's like, you know, the stress goes up. It's like, sure, I'm trying to hit some sort of dietary like goal, but then it's like, what's that doing to my stress levels? Because I haven't eaten. I don't have the cognitive ability to really process the stress in the morning with clients. So there's a lot of things where you have to kind of approach it from a life standpoint too. And I'm talking about just kind of general fitness,
right?
Because I'm not training for any games right now. But when you are training for the games, I think that's where you just have to know. You have to know from a very scientific standpoint what works for me.
Right.
And those tests are available, but if you don't have access to that, the experimentation can be a little harder.
It's again, know your body. And I think probably the top feature to let you know how your body's doing is your energy level. And so,
how do you feel?
Well, how do you feel? And I love the Snickers commercial. I don't mention a brand name where they talk about the guy here have a, you know, because brain's just shutting down. He's going crazy because he's got no sugar in his system. And so you have to understand who you are and what your activities are. I mean, we deal with a culture and society where, unfortunately, people are just strapped to a desk. And so it's like there are no calories being burned, and they won't get up and walk for a few minutes every half hour or so. And so you have to look at your day as a whole and see, you know, golly, how much have I eaten since breakfast and lunch? You know, about every 30 minutes? Well, it's not – you got to put a lock on that drawer that's got all your snacks in it because it's killing you. So you have to know yourself. If I sit at my desk and work on stuff too long, I get – hungry, but I'm not. So if I get up and walk around, then I'm okay. If I work out, then I'm way okay. So you start factoring in all of the activities and everything you do in a day so that you're able to know how much you need to eat, how much of the quality of content you need to eat, whether it's like, say, protein and carbohydrates and fats in the right order. I just am convinced now with all of our work and studies that sugar is just not good for you. You do not need sugar. Your body will manufacture it as it's needed. So just be smart enough to know that I don't need that refined element. I don't need that carbonated drink. And so supplements are good if you're not getting what you need. And so when people take a supplement and go, man, I really feel good, it's probably because they had a deficiency in the first place and the supplement corrected it.
Well, sometimes there's just some feel goods in those supplements that they sell more
Okay, yes. You know, but just be smart about it. Always read a package. I try to tell people if they're thinking, I'm going to start carrying some bars with me, to do the best you can to look at and make sure the sugars are at single digits. And because typically the trick is if you don't multiply it, because it's like per serving, and then they'll say three servings in this package. Well, now that 8 grams has gone to 24. And so you kind of have to do the math and be smart about what you're reading.
Yeah, now sugar is definitely the big one that I think I wish we had a better kind of culture around what we drink as far as sugar. That's what's really frightening
it's
to
tough.
Me. I don't drink sodas or anything anymore, but when I do just taste, like have something, I get a couple sips into it and I'm just, if you get a healthy pattern, you don't crave that stuff.
You can't stand it either when you taste it. Well, we have to look at athletes. Let me retract that. Athletes need the same type of nutrient intake as anybody else. It's their calorie expenditure that's different. You know, it's not that an athlete needs more protein. They need more calories because, let's say, I'm going to burn, you know, 700-800 more calories in a day than a 9-to-5 person. So I'd need those calories. That's the difference. It's not like I have some magical physiology that requires twice the protein, 3 times the fat, and 4 times the carbohydrates. It just needs more calories because that's what I'm burning. The body is a 24-hour chemical processing construction business and always operating. So the calories I take in as an athlete go to my sleep time when I'm recovering and the muscles are replenishing.
Input and output. Well, if you have any studies, or if you're a nutritionist or clinical you study this in a clinical setting, please let us know if you have any feedback or anything you want us to look at or touch on in the future. We always want critical feedback and scientific feedback as we create these podcasts and all this content. If you have any questions for us, one, you can leave a comment if you're on YouTube below. You can reach out to us at Coach Bob King on Twitter and Instagram. I am Deep Snap on Twitter and Instagram. And visit kingsportstraining.com, where we have training programs, courses, and all the content that's applicable. You can apply it to your training today. And so that's all we got for today. We'll talk to you next time here on the podcast.